This is the first part of a code walkthrough for the example file array1dexamples.java. This is a rather lengthy file containing lots and lots of examples of practical usage of arrays in programs. So I'm going to break this walkthrough up over multiple videos, which will correspond to the ordering of the various lecture videos. This first part is going to cover some of the basic operations of working with an array. So as always, let's start by compiling this file, and we will set a breakpoint on main, hit the debug icon, and we'll start single stepping our way through this file. So what I'll do is I'll clear this output window, and we will start stepping through here. Now in this first part, we're just setting up several integer values used to size the various arrays. We can use it as a declared constant or just as regular integer variables. In the second part, we're simply declaring some arrays. And all we're doing here is we're setting up some object references and saying that arrays of these names, of these types, are going to exist soon. So for example, and remember that when we declare an array, the brackets are part of the declaration. So this is an integer array called test scores, and a double array called daily temps, and two integer arrays called ages and item counts. We don't have workable arrays yet, but these are just object references at this point. So now, as we step through this next set of instructions, we're going to take the next step and actually instantiate the arrays. We're going to ask the compiler to set aside the indicated amount of memory big enough to hold size number of ints, or 10 doubles, or num1 ints. So as we step through these statements, notice that now these arrays come into being. For example, here's test scores. It's an array of integers of size 5, and all of the values have been auto-initialized to the default value of 0. We'll do the same thing for daily temps. Now we've got an array of size 10, and each one is initialized to 0.0 with a double. And the same thing for ages. And the same thing for item counts. Now this one is 200 long, so I'm not going to bother to expand this. So let's go a little further here. In this next set of instructions, up here we've declared the arrays as a single operation. Then we've instantiated the arrays as a single operation. Here we're just showing that we can combine those two operations into one statement, declaration and instantiation. So if we collapse these arrays a little bit more, now all of a sudden when we execute this statement, this sum data is going to come into being right away, and it's going to be initialized and memory set aside for it right away. Same thing for the measured data. Now in this next set of instructions, we're going to show what the next phase of working with an array is like, and that's initializing it. Remember that by default, numerical data is initialized to either 0 for integer data types or 0.0 for floating point data types. But what if we don't want those to be our starting defaults? Remember that we said that arrays and for loops were tightly intrinsically coupled with each other. So the way that we would initialize an array would be to use a for loop. And that for loop is always going to have the same basic structure. We're going to start with a 0 index, which is the first element of the array. We're going to loop up to the size of the array, and we're going to increment one element at a time. Then within the curly braces, this element right here represents some generic element of test scores. This is the ith element of test scores, and we're just going to set it to a constant here. So for example, here in the debugger, let's open up test scores, and all of its values are currently zeros. But as we step through this for loop, notice that all of these elements are gradually assuming their intended default values, as you see there in red. Now we've gone through this four times, we're on the fifth iteration, and now we're done. By the way, notice that things are happening under the hood behind the scenes, but we haven't seen any output to the output window yet. This is another strong argument in favor of getting familiar and comfortable with using the debugger, because you can really think of the debugger as being a code simulator of sorts. And we're going to use this debugger window here to demonstrate how the values of the various arrays change and evolve over time, even if we don't have any output yet in the output window. So getting back to the idea of initialization, here's another way that we can initialize. We've done it in a loop now. Suppose we want to initialize the values to some random values. Each one of these elements represents one piece of information of the indicated data type. So this is just like, let me look at some data here. Some data is an array of ints of size 5. So every one of these elements on the left side is simply one integer value. So all we're doing here is we're setting this integer value to 52, or we're setting this integer value to 27, and so forth. So as we go through this set of steps, watch how all of this data initializes itself. 12, 52, 27, 31, and 8. So this is another way we can initialize an array. Finally, there's a third special way we can initialize an array, and that's an initialization list. And what we can do is have the declaration of the array as usual on the left side, but on the right side, we have the desired values in a comma-separated list within curly braces, and we can create this array and initialize it in one quick statement, as we see down here. The only catch here is that we can only do this when we initially create this array. We can't come back later and update the values of this array or any other array in the same manner. So this is a one-time starting out kind of operation, or not at all. Next, let's see how we would access specific elements of an array. Remember that we said that the first element of an array was always the zeroth element, and the last element is the length minus one index. And remember that we said an array always knows its own size due to this parameter, which is always available to us. So if we look at this new data array, the first element is 12, the last element is 28.4, and we'll simply print these out. Again, this is a double value. This entire term is a double value. So there's the first element and the last element. This is very similar to strings, except that we don't have that intervening charette method. We simply index into the array within square brackets. So here's another way we can work with an array. Again, these are simply double values. So all we're doing is we're setting various values to those individual double variables. So here we're setting the first element to 14. We're setting this next element to 20 more than its current value, so this will become 76.4. The third element, the 2 index, we're going to set to 0. And here, we're just setting one double value equal to another double value. So we're going to set element 3 equal to element 2, which we've just set to 0. So now element 3 is also 0. Finally, we can do the same as with any other variable. We can set it to the result of some calculation or method call or expression. So here we're simply setting this double variable equal to the square root of pi, so roughly 1.7-ish or so. Hey, not too bad of a guess. Okay, in this final part, we've set up several arrays, and I'm going to collapse this so we can see all the arrays we've set up to this point. To initialize an array algorithmically, we can also use a for loop and set each data element equal to some expression. So for example, here's that standard for looping form. We're starting with a zero element. We're looping up to just before the end element of the array, and the end element of this array is at some data.length. So we're going to loop up to one before that. And let's take a look here. Some data is an array of size 5. So this is going to loop from I equals 0 to I less than 5. So from 0 to 4. And we're going to set each element equal to this expression. So if we're going from 0 to 4, I plus 1 is going to be 1 to 5 times 10. So we're going to set these elements algorithmically to 10 through 50. And as we cycle through this array, we can see on the left side in red all of those elements taking initialization in this for loop. Finally, the same type of operation holds when we want to actually extract or see the elements of our array. So to print all the elements of an array, we simply repeat the same standard for looping, and we're just printing out each array index and the value of the array at that index. So we'll go through this and we will simply print sum data 0 is 10. This 0 is this index I. This 10 is the sum data of the 0th element. And we can just repeat this for all the elements of an array. And printing an array is just that easy. So I'm going to stop this code walkthrough now and we'll pick back up with the next phase of it.